Welcome to the module on basics of crusher operation. Crushers are generally used to produce aggregate which can be further used in concrete, wet mix macadam and asphalt materials. So in order to make sure that the aggregates produced are meeting the requirements set for the wet mix macadam or the asphalt layers like DBM or BC, and also for the crushers, certain precautions are necessary. So in this module, we will be talking about the basics of a crusher as a part one. And in the upcoming modules, we will get into the details of how to produce aggregate for concrete or how to produce aggregates for GSB and asphalt layers or asphalt materials. What is a crushing process? Crushing is the process of reducing the size of materials so that they can be further processed. Industrial crushers are primarily used to take very large pieces of materials and make them into smaller pieces as per the requirement and utilization of the individuals. If it is for concrete, normally we go for 20 mm nominal maximum size of aggregate. If it is wet mix macadam, we go for 53 mm maximum size of aggregate, and similarly for DBM and BC, depending upon the grading adopted, we choose the size of the aggregates. What is crushing in mineral processing? If you see, crushing is the first step of mineral processing, where the ore or the rocks from the mine site is fed into the mechanical equipment in order to reduce the size of the masses for subsequent uses by liberating the valuable minerals from the gange. So how do you make an aggregate out of the boulders, or how do you make an aggregate by crushing? Crushed aggregates is produced by crushing quarry rocks, boulders, cobbles or large size gravels. Recycled concrete is a viable source of aggregate and has been satisfactorily used in granular subbases, soil cements and in new concrete. So what is crushing and screening is all about? The plants are designed to facilitate all of your mineral processing requirements, from crushing the minerals to your specifications, sorting or screening the minerals into grades, as well as mixing them into compounds to your specifications and bagging them for distributions. As discussed earlier, like, we require different sizes of materials or different sizes of aggregate for concrete and wet mix macadam or for asphalt layer. So depending upon the requirements, we can specify the sizes, and the respective sizes can be produced from the crusher by slight modification in the sieves placed in the crushing units. So what are the different types of crushing processes? If you see, crushers are classified into three types based upon the stage of crushing they accomplish. The primary crushers receives material directly from the run of mines after blasting and produces the first reduction in size. So primary crushers, secondary crushers or tertiary crushers, these are the three stages of crushing generally used in order to produce the aggregates. What is a jaw crusher? A jaw crusher uses compressive forces for breaking of particles. This mechanical pressure is achieved by the two jaws of the crusher, of which one is fixed while the other reciprocates. The jaw or toggle crusher consists of a set of vertical jaws. One jaw is kept stationary and is called as a fixed jaw, while the other jaw is called a swing jaw. Moves back and forth relative to it by a cam or a pitman mechanism, acting like a class 2 lever or a nutcracker. The jaw crusher is generally used for the primary crushers, where you put the input material as the boulders, and those boulders are being crushed to get a defined size depending upon the spacing adjusted in the jaw crusher. If you see, the volume or the cavity the two jaws is called the crushing chambers. You place the boulders on top of it, and because of the movement of the levers, the pressure develops, and slowly the bigger boulders are being crushed into the smaller particles. Now, the output of the size of the aggregate which is coming out of the jaw crusher depends upon the gap which is being maintained in the bottommost location between the two jaws. The movement of the swing jaw can be quite small. Since complete crushing is not performed in one stroke, it is a repetitive process, whereas the one which is stationary and the one which is in motion always gets an impact form motion by swinging, and thus creating a space by expanding and contracting the spaces and creating a pressure to crush the boulders into small pieces. The inertia required to crush the material is provided by the flywheel that moves a shaft, creating an eccentric motion that causes the closing of the gap and thereby resulting a force which is crushing the boulders into the aggregates. The boulders are being fed into the primary jaw crusher, and thereafter, because of the action of the primary jaw crusher, the boulders of size 300 mm can be broken down into 40 to 50 to 60 millimeter sizes are being shown in this video. Now, what is a reduction ratio generally mentioned for crushers is? The reduction ratio is broadly defined as the ratio of the feed size to the product size in any crushing operation. It is very useful in determining what a crusher can do or is doing in the way of size reduction. How does a crushing plant works? Raw materials are evenly and gradually conveyed into jaw stone crushing equipments for primary crushing via the hopper of the vibrating feeders. The crushed stone materials are conveyed to crushing plant by a belt conveyor for secondary crushing before they are sent to the vibrating screen to be separated, and thereafter finally it can be sent to the tertiary crushing or the VSI for giving a final shape of the aggregates. Now, the quality or the hardness of the material which is being used for jaw crusher depends upon the type of the aggregate is being used. That is the reason why we test the impact test of aggregates. Depending upon the impact value and the crushing value of the aggregates, the jaws, hardness of the jaws are being chosen in the crushing plant. What is a jaw crusher used for? The jaw crushers are generally used for breaking the large size rocks or ores by placing the rock into compression. The fixed jaw mounted in a V alignment is the stationary breaking surface, while the movable jaw exerts force on the rock by forcing it against the stationary plate, thereby developing a pressure and resulting in a force which is ultimately crushing the boulders into aggregates. What is a cone crusher used for? A cone crushers are type of a compression crusher used by aggregate, coal, concrete crushing, fracking sands and mining industries, which reduces materials by squeezing or compressing it until it breaks. And what is an impact crusher or a VSI is generally used for? An impact crusher is a machine that uses striking as opposed to the pressure to reduce the size of a material. Impact crushers are designed as a primary, secondary, or tertiary or quaternary rotor crushers depending on which processing stage the equipment is being utilized. How do you calculate the reduction ratio for a crusher? The reduction or the gear ratio is calculated by dividing the number of teeth on the larger gear by the number of teeth on the smaller gear. For example, if an electric motor drives a 13 tooth pinion gear that meshes with a 65 tooth gear, a reduction of 5:1 is achieved. That is nothing but the ratio of 65 by 13, which is equal to 5. Now, if you look at the typical crushing process for a crusher having a three-stage crushing, we have a quarry where we produce the boulders of say size 300 millimeters. Those boulders are being transported from the quarry and fed into the primary crusher, which is basically a jaw crusher. Now, from in the jaw crusher, the 300 mm size aggregates are being crushed to get a size of a range between 50 to 60 millimeters, which is being stored intermittently in the storage container. It can be directly sent to the primary cones also, but if it is sent directly, the possibility of choking the primary cones is high. That is the reason why it is being stored intermittently and batch-wise, and slowly the aggregates are being fed into the primary cone, say which is having a capacity say around 300 TPH, for example. That means the boulders which are received of the size of 300 millimeters are being fed to the primary crusher, and from the primary crusher you are getting a aggregate of size 50 to 60 millimeters, which is being fed to the primary cone crusher having a capacity of 300 tons per hour output. Now, the output of the primary cone will result in a reduction in size from 50 to 60 to 40 millimeters, and these 40 millimeter aggregates are being fed to a vibrating screen where the aggregates are being sieved on a 40 mm single size sieve. Now, 40 mm sieve, these are the rounded sieves being punched on a steel plate of required like suitable thickness, maybe around 5 mm or 3 to 5 mm thickness, to just to ensure that the stability because of the impact and loading of the aggregates. Now, once the aggregates are being fed, whatever the size below 40 mm is there, that is being passed through the 40 mm screen, and generally a 25 plus minus 3 mm, that means around 25 to 30 millimeter aggregates or 25 to 28 millimeter size aggregates are being the output of the vibrating screen, which is being fed to the vertical shaft impact or the tertiary crusher, which is having a capacity of 400 TPH. And the aggregates which are being retained on the 40 mm screens, that is the oversized aggregates, oversized than the 40 mm, are being fed to the secondary cone crusher, which is having a capacity of 120 TPH, which is lesser than the primary cone capacity, primary cone crushing capacity. Now, the aggregates which are being crushed from the VSI, or the aggregates which are being crushed from the secondary cone crushers, and the aggregates which are being sieved from the vibratory screens are together being fed to the VSI, and the output of the VSI is being fed to the another screen, which is having a three layer screens, the maximum size being on the top and the smaller size on the bottom. And anything over than the 20 mm size aggregates are being fed again to the 40 mm vibrating screen to reroute it again to the VSI. Now, once the screen is being set, the output of the materials you get from the final output are 20 mm sand and 10 mm as the final output of the crushing unit. This is the typical layout which is generally observed on a tertiary or a three-stage crushing with vertical shaft impact. Now, if you see the steps in crushing in a nutshell, you get the material in the quarry which is having a size of say 300 millimeters of boulder size, which is being fed to the primary, and the output of the primary is 50 to 60 millimeters of aggregate size, which is intermittently stored in between but finally fed to the primary cone crusher, which is giving you an output of 40 mm size aggregate. That means the input is 50 to 60 millimeter aggregate size and is further crushed in the primary cone crusher to reduce the size from 50 to 60 to 40 millimeter size. Now, from the primary cone crusher, which is having an output of 40 mm size, is being fed to a screen which is having a single size sieve of 40 millimeters, which is the size of the sieve is rounded in shape. That means the maximum size which can pass through the sieve is 40 millimeters, because the diagonal is 40 millimeters in this case, because when the sieves are when the sieve sizes are of the shape of round lid, that means you are allowing the maximum size possible. But if it is a square, then 40mm square means the diagonal will be more than 40, that is 40 plus 40, 40 square plus 40 square root 100. So it will be more than that. So then you will have a nominal size of screen sizes. But in this particular case, it is 40 maximum size of sieve size. So anything over the 40mm size is being rerouted to the secondary cone, and the passing aggregates are being routed to the VSI. Now, once it goes to the VSI, then again, after the production of the VSI, it is being screened at three layers. The sieves are of three stages, like first sieve is 23 millimeters square shape. Second sieve below the 23mm sieve is 12mm sieve, which is again the square shape. And then the third screen is 6mm, which is again the square sieve. So you have square mesh of three layers, which is the 23, 12, and 6mm. So all the aggregates which are being retained on 23mm are being collected separately. Retained on 12mm can be collected separately, and retained on 6mm can be collected separately. And passing through 6mm is collected as the sand content. Now, which is retained on the 23 millimeters is being collected as the oversize aggregate, and is being again fed to the 40mm screen size to again route it through the VSI for further reduction in the sizes. So if you say typically the crushing, the three stage crushing, you have an input of 300 millimeters, which is being crushed prior to the primary crusher to give an output in the shape of 50 to 60, which is being connected to the primary cone crusher and then gives an output of 40mm aggregate, and which again is being converted to the fed to the vertical shaft impact or VSI, which is a tertiary cone crusher, to get an output of 2010 and crusher dust. So this is typically the requirement you get normally for concrete, because in the concrete you require a nominal maximum size of aggregate is 20mm. So this setup is best suited to use this aggregate as a best aggregate or the fulfilling requirement as far as the grading is concerned. And since it is passing through VSI, so the flakiness and elongation index also can be achieved perfectly. So if you see the final output of the crusher, once it has passed through the VSI crusher, which is having, say, the design capacity is 400 TPH, but probably it will work at 80% of the design capacity. So the working capacity will be less than the 400 TPH capacity, say around 320 or 330 the working capacity is. Now, out of that working capacity, generally, you get an oversize of 10% depending upon the type of the sieve you have put on top of it. And then you get 20mm in the range of, say, 27%, crush sand around 45%, and 10mm aggregate around 18%. So the controls, if you see the controls required during the crushing is, if you want to improve the efficiency, you need to improve the feeding quality, and you need to have a control on the dust suppression because of the environmental issues. Like you need to check the air qualities, you need to cover the conveyors throughout the process, and there has to be a spraying arrangement in primary crusher as well as in the conveyors which carries the aggregates, because if it is being covered, then the dust separation will be effective. And in order to optimize the production quantity, you need to fine tune the sieves, you need to fine tune the gaps between the primary crusher jaw plates, and also you need to work on the amount of, because the more it is routed through VSI, the more is the percentage of dust. So generally, if flakiness elongation is not that critical, and if you are able to achieve the flakiness and elongation through your secondary crushing, which comes generally in the range of, say, 35 to 30 to 35%, then probably you can avoid the VSI, because the moment you adopt VSI, your production of dust increases and you will lose 20 and 10 mm in the process. So to optimize the production requirements, generally you can bypass if it is meeting your VSI requirements, if it is meeting your flakiness and elongation requirements. But definitely for asphalt works, especially for bituminous concrete, the aggregates must be routed through the VSI. So depending upon the need, the VSI utilization can be initiated so that the production can be optimized. And whatever the production is being happening with VSI or without a VSI, it is always advisable to store them separately so that the separate quantities can be ensured to utilize them for the right purpose. Then this is how you can control the size of the aggregates. So to control the size of the aggregates, you need to control the shape, you need to control the gap between the primary crusher jaw, you need to control the sieves, size of the sieves, and also you need to make sure, depending upon what type of sieves you are using, if it is a plate with a rounded openings, then you are actually giving the maximum size of aggregate. But if it is a wire mesh, you are giving the nominal size of aggregate. So depending upon that, you have to have a calculation to understand that what is your requirement and what is the gap you can maintain, so that the output, the final output, will always meet the requirement set by you. So to summarize this module, in this particular module, we talked about what is crushing, how do we make aggregates out of boulders, the three stage crushing process, the steps in the crushing process, the different stages of crushing, and the controls required during crushing operation in order to optimize the production, also in order to minimize the wastages. Thank you very much for watching. Do tune in for more updates.